Alright, Kiss Army. It's time to drop the needle, kiss my wax.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the next episode of Kiss My Wax. I am one of your co-hosts, Jason Herndon, and with me, as always, is Mr. Tom Shannon. That's right. How you doing, Tom?
Doing good. What about you, Jason?
I'm all right. So, on this episode of Pawn Stars, that's how that show starts. episode of Kiss My Wax, we are going to discuss something that kind of gets a little heated in our group from time to time, but we just figured we might spend a little more time on it as we've touched on these topics on many of the podcasts. But we're going to dedicate a little time here in this one and talk about counterfeits versus bootlegs versus official releases. And those definitions, those titles, how we arrive at them for certain releases, and why we'd like to stick to categorizing things in those three columns and everything. So we're going to discuss that a little bit, and then we're also going to talk about some fun stuff. We're going to talk about some of the oddity records, records that in the catalog that only come out in certain countries or have certain covers that are different than the norm and all that stuff. We're going to touch on that. And we've touched on those in other podcasts as well, but we're just going to kind of group them all together here. We probably won't hit all of them. But we're gonna
touch everyone you have and I have and some we don't have.
That's right. So, and that's been the goal of the podcast all along. There's no way we can show everything, but we'll show as much as we can. And then some other fun topics. So there's our intro. Where do you want to start?
Let me start first. Let's talk about the worldwide Kiss LP book that I've been working on. That's going to be coming out, getting closer and closer now. Made an announcement on the page the other day that's Kiss My Wax Facebook page. By the way, I realize some people don't know where the page is, haven't seen it. I made an announcement the other day that I stopped in to visit a local printer. Who was working on another project for me as well that I'll show you here in a little bit. And, kind of trying to get an idea of, first of all, how big is this thing physically going to be? What's it going to take? And so I sat down the other night with my latest count of photos and got a word count, which is, a little odd on the word count because it's basically the list of variations, I mean, that's going to be the text in it, most of the text. But anyway, as I got those numbers together, I think if I recall the photos that I've got right now was 1900 and something. And the word text was, I can't remember, but bottom line is, as I sat down and started dividing out the photos into how many I would want to see on a page, that's going to be a big determining factor on what the cost is going to be for everything. Because this is the first book that I put out, Goldmine Kiss Collectibles Price Guide. This book is 176 pages. And I'll try to find a good page that's got an example of it. You just have to kind of look at this and go from here. But I really don't want these labels being any smaller than what they appeared in here.
I agree.
So that means in this book, the most labels I can get on a page is 6. Okay. I took Hank's book with me also, which is just his book on 7-inch Kiss vinyl. And I know it'll be hard to see because they're both black, but his is actually just a little bit taller than mine.
Yeah.
Either one of those could have been done. And, hey, there's my figures there. And Hank and his, he's got 12 per page, but it's kind of different because, these are picture sleeves for a 7-inch. So, there's not as much detail on those things and you can make out the variations on there. I mean, for me, and same thing with with the actual label, it's much less text on these things. So anyway, I decided I didn't want to have any more than six per page because I, you know, you need to be able to see the differences in the labels. So that ends up putting the book photos at 318 pages. Okay. So two of these would be 352 pages. So that gives me another 35 or so pages to fool with if I don't get rid of any photos I've got now, which I probably will. I'm still photo editing. But the bottom line is it became evident to me real quick the photos need to go in two books this size. I talked to them about doing a book twice as thick, and it can be done. It'll, you know, the binding won't fall apart, same kind of deal. But the more I thought about it, I just think it'd be easier to handle if it was two. I don't think it'll be any more expensive. I'm going to price it up both ways with the printer, but I don't, it's going to end up being three volumes. It'll be two volumes full of nothing, essentially, but photos. There may be a few text things in there. Just depends on how the all the text fits into the third volume. And the reason why I'm doing that is because I will sell singles of that text of the label variations. If somebody doesn't feel like it fits their budget, it's going to be expensive. Three of these in a slipcase is going to be expensive. I don't know how much.
Right.
This book sold in 2000 for $25.
Right.
So with no inflation, if I could even get it at the same kind of level, that's $75 for all three of them without the slipcase.
Right.
I get it. That's a lot of money. Okay. I think people that you know, have the ability to pay it are going to want it, you know, but I understand some people won't. So I will offer by itself the text that's going to have all the label variations. So
I'll buy an individual copy as well, because that'll be my copy I want to write in.
Well, that's what some people may do. I didn't even think about that. Yeah. I didn't think about that. I was literally thinking, I've actually had somebody contact me today, and I told him what I was going to be doing, and he's a college student. And he said that he didn't want to mention anything on the page because he catches some shit sometimes talking about trying to be on a budget. And, you know, we shouldn't be doing that.
We should not be doing that.
Hey, there's all different income levels with this hobby. So, you know, we need to have some respect for everybody like that.
I agree.
But I assured him that, you know, like, I work with him. I'm not going to hold a leather-bound set because I'm probably going to do leather-bound as well. They're pricing that up. I want one. I may not sell, but two. Maybe it's me and one other. I don't know.
One. You think it'll be worth $500?
No, surely not. Surely not.
I
would think surely not. If it is, I'm getting one. But anyway, I'll tell you, one's going to get made. But, you know, like, I'm not going to hold on to a leather-bound set for somebody to get the money. But I'll work with somebody. You know, we're all supposed to be friends on this stuff.
That's right.
So, anyway, that's that. The picture that Jason's probably showing you is probably not going to be close to what this thing's going to look like.
Then
now.
I'll show it then.
No, that's fine. You can show it because Danny's worked hard on that. And I'll be working with Danny going in the future on this as well. Somehow I got to combine all three together, and, you know, there's some others as far as making them.
Oh, yeah,
flow.
You got to have three covers now. I didn't even think about it. Are you going to replicate it, or are you going to make some kind of...
Probably not. And Michael Stone, one of the members, he's got a good idea, but I'm very leery of people trying to sue me. And, you know, he said, well, you need a blue label, a camel label, and a Filmworks label one. And he's right, but I don't know if I can do that. I'll have to look at it. I'll assure you, if it is, it will not say KISS on it there. So it's, you know, we'll see how that works. And that is the other thing.
You think somebody would sue you over the design of the label?
Universal probably could, yeah. Yeah, I don't think they would, you know.
Huh.
I mean, they're not going after the counterfeiters, you know.
True.
We'll be discussing it a little bit, but, yeah, that's not worth the effort for me, you know. I'm not going to go bankrupt because I got to, you know, pay all the proceeds from this. Whatever. Anyway.
Got it.
Just got to think about that kind of stuff, man. But anyway, so there we go. So we're getting closer. If I was going to give you a guess, I know I've got another 4 weeks worth of just grunt work on the photo editing to go. And then I've got to get a program and start laying this thing out. So either that or else pay them to do it. And I kind of like doing that stuff anyway. So I know we're a good 6 weeks away probably the time this goes, we're at least a month away from me having an idea of when it might come out. So, but it's coming. It's coming. I'm not as concerned about somebody else putting one out in front of me now. Man, this is a bunch of work. It is insane. And have had a ton of help, a lot of contributions. So,
sure,
you know, we're right at 1,500 variations. I thought I passed it. And the way I've been keeping up with it on my spreadsheet, at the far left-hand side, I've got a column. And once I verify a variation, I put a one in there. And it literally just counts it. And so everything's all cool until I found a number 11 in one of them last night.
Oh, no.
So I'm about six short right now. So we'll hit the 1,500. Yeah, yeah. I was like, are you kidding me? So anyway. So there's that. There's the thing about the book. All right. So now let's.
No, hold on. One question about the book. Timeline-wise. So once you get to the end of editing and everything that you're going to do, once the text of it is complete and you're ready to go to press with it, what kind of a timeline from that do you think?
I don't know. I will be able to tell you, because I can tell you right now, I'm going to be pre-selling this thing. I cannot come out of my pocket to pay for this printing.
Okay.
You know, and that'll be part of what determines, you know, the level of the printing that goes on as well.
Gotcha.
And by that, I just mean some things move. Like, you know, let's say I have to have 200 reservations to break even. If I only hit 150, everybody's gonna get their money back. Because
that's right.
I'm not losing money on it. I'm not looking to make money on this, but I am not going to lose money on this. You know,
right.
I mean, just isn't any point. But I don't know what that break even point is right now until I get the information from the printer. And that's like I told the printer, they're asking me how many did I need to do. And I'm just taking a guess, because like I told them, this gold mine one, it sold 7,500 copies. Okay. I'm not going to be selling 7,500 LP copies. It's not going to happen. Okay. For the same reason why, what's our membership here right now? Are we at four or just under it or something like that?
3,550 or something.
Yeah. 3,500 people here. And how many are over at Kiss My Kollectibles? Past 5,000.
Past 5,000. Correct.
Yeah. And so we just started. Well, I'm not helping run it now, but that Kiss My Kollectibles just started. And yet it's run past it. There are more general Kiss collectors than
That's
there
correct.
Are Kiss vinyl collectors.
That's
so I'm just taking a guess at that 1,000. Now, I told him you need to price me, because, you know, pencil marks are cheap. You know, it doesn't take anything to add another pencil mark. I needed him to tell me what's the price breaks at different levels. Because, you know, if sometimes it actually makes more sense to print more than you're going to have a chance to sell.
Sure.
Because your price gets cheaper.
Always.
You know, yeah. I mean, I was giving you the example, Jason, earlier about, I've got to get holograms made for this Rockologist that I'm doing. And, 1,000 of them is $400. That's 40 cents each. Well, if I can order 9,000, it gets a hell of a lot cheaper than 40 cents each.
Right.
But I can't do that right now.
Right.
But you see what I'm saying? But it may make sense to print more up than I'm going to sell, but I've got to hit a break even point. And that,
sure.
You know, it happened really quick on another project that we'll talk about here in a second.
Yep.
But, you know, I really don't have any anticipation where it's going to go. I tell you, the book's going to get made. I may be sitting on the only copy, but it's going to get made.
Okay? At least make two.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure that we would do it. But you get what I'm saying. You get what I'm saying? Like if I can't, I would have no, please, nobody think this is the price of this. I'm doing this hypothetically. But if those three volumes came in at $200, nobody's going to want to buy that. Okay?
That's right. And
I'm not going to do it on the cheap. It's going to be good quality. I'm not going to put 12, 15 labels on a page, because then what's the point? You know?
Yeah.
So, anyway, should all be good. We'll see.
All right. Sounds good. All right. What do you want to move on to next?
All right, so now let's move on to the Rockologists and Kiss My Wax and Bruce Kulick presenting the authorized special edition of BK3.
Yep.
By this point, I'm sure most of these people that are watching this are aware, you can't buy another copy now. We're at the point that this should be showing, I should be picking up the posters from my printer and the Obies and hustling my butt to the post office to get them out to Bruce. He should get them sometime next week and be doing the signatures on those. By the time this airs, I've already got all the LPs here. Bruce is, he's working, well, he's worked in the past signing those. This project, I want to thank everybody for this. This is the first project like this that I put together. It's been a lot of fun. It's been really interesting for me. I can't say there's been any heartache or anything involved in it. Appreciate everybody's patience, understanding why it was pre-sold. I had to pre-sell at least 37 copies of this LP because at the time Bruce was going to allow me to get 60 of them from him that he was signing and all that. And then he was going to hold on to some more. And I get that. So I needed to sell a minimum of 37 copies on a pre-sale to be able to get to a break-even point with him and then, work on paying my printer and stuff. And, we hit that in 15 minutes after it went on sale, and it was way past sold out in an hour. I did these orders manually. Appreciate people's patience on that. It is unfortunate there are some people that had typos in the emails that they were responding to me on, and their reservation did not get in time. They all got contacted and put on the reserve list, which may or may not have taken care of itself by this time. I know it pre-sold over 100, even though I only had 60. And again, right, that's because it was on email instead of being on PayPal where it could have a maximum number and then cut off. The reason why I didn't do it on PayPal is I was looking around trying to find information. I could not find a way that I could make PayPal limit people on the number of copies that they bought, limit them to two or one for the first day. And then two, had a couple of people that, said that wouldn't be fair if everybody didn't get a chance to buy them. Ironically enough, neither one of those people ever bothered to put an order in. So, that's, thank you for that. That was a lot of trouble for me. But anyway, bottom line, it's the project went great. Bruce immediately made another 80 available. He's down to about
another 80.
No, I'm sorry. Another 20 for a total of 80.
Yes.
A total of 80. And now Bruce is down under 10 copies left that he owns. And he even helped make arrangements, and not just help make them, he made the arrangements for a dealer that was sitting on a little bit of inventory of the signed copies, so I could purchase those. So we've got a total of 90 that are coming in here. I'm holding on to two or three of them just in case there's any kind of issues with anybody's. So it's been well beyond what I hoped would happen with it. Well, not well beyond that, but it's gone very well. I think people are going to like them again. You get multiple things with this. This is not just about buying the LP, although it is about buying the LP. Play these things, people. It's some great music on this. There's some great artists on it. As I got to looking through the credits and stuff, which I really hadn't done that much, and you'll find these on the OB, Gene Simmons is on there. Eric Singer's on there. Nick Simmons is on there. Who else is on there? Got John Karabi is on there.
Yeah.
Doug Feiger from the Knack is on there. Yep. I mean, a lot of big people on here. And Bruce, clearly and Bruce. Bruce, yeah. And so you're getting great music, you're getting an autographed cover, you're getting a certification signed by Bruce saying that is his signature on the cover. Both of those items are going to have holograms on them. They're going to be numbered so that in the future, if you ever do want to sell it, somebody will be able to go to the website that I'll have up. Isn't up right now, but they will. And you'll be able to look that up and document that that is what this item is. I'm giving everybody a money back, a buyback guarantee on it. You know, in 36 months, if you still got all your certificates, which the buyback is a certificate as well. If you've got all your certificates, if that LP is still sealed, then I will buy it back from you for the $65 that you paid for it. Okay. I'm not going to pay you shipping. You know, I'm not going to pay you to ship it back to me. But, and the reason why I'm doing that is because, you know, to me, this is going to be a highly, it's already a highly collectible record. I mean, you know, and it just is. So, you know, it's a cool thing. You know, like I say, by the time you see this, you will be within just a little bit of time of you getting these back. I put an original expected shipping date of 6 to 8 weeks after you ordered. I did that for legal reasons. You know, if they have a UPS strike or something that shuts it down yeah. and I don't deliver this, some ass is going to sue me. And that's just the way it is. So, yeah. you know, got to cover that. But I don't anticipate it being that long. So. You know, I think everybody's going to enjoy them when they get them. And like I say, this is not the end of projects. You know, there's going to be a lot of not just KISS related either. Although obviously I'm going to do as much KISS stuff as I can, but other artists as well, as far as like concert used equipment and recording session used equipment. And, you know, definitely want to do a lot more of these signed LPs. So
for sure. Sure.
Yep. All right. So that's that.
That was a load of information on a couple of projects.
It is, man. It is. Yeah. I mean, I'm having a lot of fun. Man, there's a lot going on. I got a job, too, you know?
Yeah. And a wife and a life and
mm-hmm.
a dog yep. and all kinds yep. of stuff. A daughter.
Yeah.
So.
All right. So let's see. So we talked about the book. We talked about the BK3.
Mm-hmm.
Did you get anything you need to open?
I only bought one thing, I think. Well, I'm going to show this too because it's kind of vinyl related. It's bootleg vinyl related. But no, I showed you this in a picture. The label is not in the greatest of shape, but I had to pick it up because of what it was. I only paid $3 for it. But it's
yeah.
camel label of Paul's solo album,
yeah.
which is odd enough. And the other side is very roached. But I'll show it because it's got this is not a promo, but it's got a date on it. And, what is that, 8 second mark or something like
yeah,
that? I don't know.
Yeah,
it almost looks like it was sitting at a radio station or something. But
it does. It does. I noticed that when you first sent it, and it was like, man, that's a man. Where'd you get that? Well, maybe you shouldn't tell me where you got. I've got a local store that puts those stickers on there just exactly like that.
You know, I don't know. I'll have to look.
I'll be curious. Yeah, don't say it here, but get back with me because yeah. I mean, did you get it from a member here?
Oh no! I bought it on eBay. On eBay.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah. Definitely check it. Cause
yeah,
I hate to say this, but that's about the kind of quality that, they put out there as well.
Yeah. It's interesting. How the label is, you know, I mean, it's just peeled up.
Yeah.
I don't know. I've never seen anything like it. It's very,
oh, geez. I got a bunch like that.
Do you? I have, yeah. you know, all these records, I have nothing like that.
Yeah, I don't show that kind of stuff normally, but yeah, I've got stuff like that.
No, you know, but anyway, $3 and I, you know,
yeah,
I wanted to get that. So,
yeah,
and
then the other cool. thing,
I had mentioned a long time ago that I had this particular, get in there, I had this particular bootleg. Look, even the sleeve sucks. So, anyway, I had this particular bootleg. That's a very cool set. It's this Budokan thing. There's all kinds of stuff in here, replica tickets and pictures and stuff like
crap.
That. But huh?
I said, holy crap! Look how thick that thing is.
Yeah. I mean, it's a cool bootleg.
Yeah.
And but anyway, one of the things that it came with was this kind of a burlap kind of bag that it sits in. And when I bought my copy, I bought it off eBay, and it didn't have the bag. And a friend of mine saw me mention that somewhere. I might have mentioned it on the page a long time ago. And he was like, hey, I kind of knew who was involved in the project. So I can just send you one of these for like $10. So I got my
that's cool.
For it.
Yeah.
So anyway, the package is supposed to go
a record bag, man. It's a record bag, not a burlap bag. You don't carry burlap in that.
anyway. So anyway, yeah. I got that for $10 from
a good
friend of mine to complete that package, which I would have probably had to pay $300 or $400 to just get that bag, and because those things are out of print and they fetch quite a bit of coin on eBay now. So
I bet they do. Bet they do.
So anyway, so that's all I've bought. I haven't actually. Did I show this last time? Did I show this bootleg last time?
No.
I think
atrocities. Atrocities. Who is naming these things, man?
I don't know.
You know, talking about Mylar and atrocities.
Yeah.
And
I think I saw this. I think I showed it on episode of Kiss My Boots, the bootleg podcast that I also am a part of. But this is like everything that they did in, all the recordings from 73. So it's got
really
Kramer demos. It's got the Ten East 23rd Street. It's got the Daisy Show. First and second set. It's got the Coventry audio from the video, but it also has the unreleased Coventry two tracks from the night before that got recorded over for the second night of Coventry, and then it's got the Academy of Music in this nice little package, and so
cool.
I have all of those shows. Probably in better quality, but it was cool to have them all packaged in one place.
Yeah, I like that.
So anyway, so that's all I've got. Did you buy anything? I think you bought
something. Yeah, I did. And you know, the people that are on the page have already seen this.
Yeah.
But a few episodes came on and psyched you out, holding up, two of these things. And they ended up being Kansas records. And I was going on and on about, what the hell? I mean, I get these Kansas Burns Medias. And what a Burns Media consultants is, they provided, syndicated radio shows. I think I've wore people out with this, but the Burns there is George Burns, the guy who was God and Oh God, the old ancient actor. Well, old dead actor now, but so you can find the Kansas ones all the time. You can find the
Crystal Gale,
a bunch of different ones. Yeah, Crystal Gale, but you can't find the Kiss for whatever reason. And so there it is. Our good buddy over at Three Sides, Mark Sakini, was contacted by a record store in Arizona that had this record. They had bought it in a big, huge collection. And, the guy told me when I talked to him at the record store, he said, yeah, man, he said, I've seen the Crystal Gale ones and stuff. He said, I figured I got $15 or $20 here. And he said, so he did the right thing and started doing some research and, ended up finding, Three Sides of the Coin with Mark talking about this, about how rare it was. And so he got a hold of Mark, and Mark got in touch with me because Mark already has a copy, And this is the first copy I've ever had a chance to buy. And, I was very fortunate too. I probably better not mention his name here, although I don't know if he'd get upset if I did or not. But one of our page members, of course, I needed to raise some cash pretty quick. And, he purchased a spare Greatest Kiss that I had with the insert sheet. And then I had a little bit more and I was able to get this. Now this thing is still in the shrink, which I normally rip that stuff off even on a record this old, but I don't think I'm going to with this one.
Yeah.
And this thing is just, I'm pretty sure it's never even been on a turntable. Yeah.
If it has one time to air it on particular episodes.
I think, and I'm sure you can find these labels somewhere, but I'm not going to show this because I'm anal like that. I don't want somebody getting some information they shouldn't. But something struck me on this. On the label, the code number for this is BMC001. Their first show.
Interesting.
Burns Media's first show.
Well, probably
did not have good distribution.
That's it.
They probably didn't print up any more than what they needed, or maybe even had to throw some away or something. And that kind of explains why this thing is so tough to find. Yeah. But I'll say this, my Kansas ones, no code number on them. I don't know if they just stopped bothering, but I'm feeling pretty confident. This was so early in 76 and, you know, the cans of stuff had to come out after this because it's leftover cure and some other stuff. So, you know, so anyway, so got that. And you know what? We probably can segue into our next portion based on this.
Yep.
Okay. All right. So, you know, this brings us to a pretty nice segue into our discussion that we're going to have here in a minute. Jason, would you classify this as a authorized KISS record, a counterfeit KISS record, or a bootleg KISS record? It's got to be one of the three.
It's authorized.
It is. It is, in my opinion, too. And part of that is, if I was going to show you the label, it's got the KISS logo on it.
Yes.
But, you know, they authorized Burns Media to release this thing. So,
correct.
Even though it's a, you know, it's a record, I'm sorry, a radio show, it's still an authorized record. So let's talk about counterfeits, bootlegs, authorized. Give us some definitions, man. What all those three mean?
Quick and dirty. Authorized, sanctioned by the band or the label or whoever the rights owner was. Okay?
Yeah.
Of that particular thing or recording or whatever it is. Bootlegs. Bootlegs would be records or CDs or videos or whatever that are distributed in some sort of way that is usually unofficially released material, many times live recordings. I guess maybe, well, we won't, let's don't do any gray area stuff. Unofficial live recordings for the most part, and then counterfeits would be something that is produced that, you know, generally releases authorized material that is used to made to fool you into thinking that it's real, or let's just stick with that.
Yeah.
So quick and dirty.
Well, somebody had a good definition the other day on the page, although it as far as how to I think authorize, we can all agree what that is.
Right.
You know, I don't think there's ever been any argument with anybody. I mean, unless you're just fresh to it and you don't understand the concepts of bootlegs and stuff.
Well, before you go into those, I do think that some people, because we had gotten into a discussion before, I don't know if it's been in the group or in PMs or something like that, about these radio shows. Are these radio shows authorized?
Oh, they're authorized, clearly.
Right.
Clearly.
Are these live recordings, like when Metal Shop, a syndicated radio show would run like a live concert or something. Was that authorized? Yes.
Yeah. Yes, they are. Now, where that gets into a weird spot, like, you know, we'll just use this. And look, you know, we are wide open if anybody's got ideas that differ from this. Okay. I will say that these are, we have not just thrown this stuff out here. Well, there's been a lot of discussion to come up with how are we going to differ this stuff, because it's important, especially to new collectors, that they know what the stuff is. Okay.
Right.
So this, again, authorized. Okay. Even though Casablanca did not put this out, this is from 1976, even though there's no KISS logo on the outside of it, I would tell you, even if there wasn't a KISS logo on the label, which there is, this is still authorized.
Absolutely.
Okay? The second that you put this onto a CD, a cassette, an 8-track, color vinyl, make a color cover for the actual disc that's in here, it's a counterfeit.
That's right.
Okay? The original of it is authorized, but no alteration. You can't do alterations. And at that point, it's not a bootleg then, it's a counterfeit.
It's not a bootleg.
So no. somebody had a great definition, but I do think I could see where it would cause some cloudiness around bootlegs.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have the problem with it. I don't have the problem that it causes any cloudiness around it. This person said that the second that you use the KISS logo, the KISS name, or a KISS recording, you're counterfeit. And he's right. So I could see how somebody could say, and I wouldn't argue with them, could say that a bootleg is a subset of a counterfeit. To me, that's not really the way to go.
Right.
But what that definition does cover are these, is stuff like,
stuff like this.
We got, there you go. Perfect. Perfect. Yeah. Yeah. Because that is a counterfeit. Now, mind you, I think most people think that that's fine. Yeah. There you go. That is a counterfeit, even though it never appeared in vinyl. This is a counterfeit.
Correct.
This is Love Gun from Russia. This is what they got over. This is a counterfeit.
Right.
Okay. What really got this stirred up again the other day was yet another Love Gun on colored vinyl.
Blue. Right?
Some, yes, blue vinyl.
Here's now, here's my counterfeit red.
Okay.
So.
Now, there is a real red. So that's where that really is a problem.
Yes.
Now, my hat is off to them that they did it in blue.
Correct.
Okay. I think that's what a lot of people are saying. If you're going to do these, don't replicate the real thing like that. But it is still a counterfeit. I don't know how you can look at it another way. And you know what? If you personally feel like that is not a counterfeit, that is fine. You are entitled to your opinion. I will tell you that we have an editorial position on the Kiss My Wax page that is a counterfeit. Okay? That's a well thought out process to come to that. I appreciate that people show them there, because how else do we know that they're out there?
That's right.
You know, how do we educate people that they are? Would I purchase one? Yes. For $10, I would. Am I going to say anything to you if you purchase one for $200? I'm not. Am I going to say something if you sit there and say, I think all these are worth $200. These are really great and collectible. No, I'm coming out and I'm going to say something.
That's right.
Because it's not, and that's your opinion at that point. It's okay if you want to buy it at that. If you want to lose your money on it that way, that's your call. None of my business. But yeah, you know, we want to encourage the exchange of ideas. But now, when you post that up there and act like you don't know it's a counterfeit, that's going to get it thrown off the page.
Right.
You're going to be told that you need, well, you may not even be told anymore. It happens so much. But at best, you're going to be told you need to repost this and say this is a counterfeit, so people know what they're looking at, instead of getting all excited because they think somebody's put out an authorized blue vinyl Love Gun. When you go to the trouble of writing a paragraph this long about why you don't think that's a counterfeit, okay, you're poking me in the eye, you're poking Jason in the eye, you're going against the set of editorial positions that you had to read to even join our page.
That's right.
You notice I say that? You joined our page. You know? There are lots of pages I don't belong to because I don't agree with their position on stuff.
Amen.
Kiss stuff, political stuff, a bunch. And, you know, it would be like me being Donald Trump and going on MSNBC and deciding to argue with you about your political position.
It would be pointless.
Exactly. Totally pointless.
Totally pointless.
You can, we welcome all ideas. This idea, we've had people throw out the word censorship.
Yep.
This is not censorship. We're telling you, you're not in the ideal of the page. You know, you're like a member of the KKK that showed up to a Black Lives Matters march. You are. You are. It's not that serious, obviously, but you get what I'm saying. It's that diametrically opposed. It's that diametrically opposed, you know, and I respect that people like these. Okay. I probably know the people that are making them. I don't know that, but I'll bet you I do, you know, and I'm sure it just probably kills them every time I say this stuff, but you know, they know what they're doing.
Yeah.
And that's fine. But what's not good, people act like, well, everybody knows this. No, they don't. People get ripped off on this crap all the time.
That's my biggest issue with the whole thing, is that the people that defend it and think that it's great, and these are missed opportunities by Kiss. Yeah. All that may be true, that it's missed opportunities by Kiss, and Kiss could have, or the label, it's not Kiss, mm-hmm. it's the label, missed opportunities by them to make a bunch of money. But the vast majority, I would say the vast majority of the collectors out there are not seasoned collectors. You know, there's a bunch of seasoned collectors, but there's quite a bit of people that don't spend their lives
right,
in a
right.
Facebook group just right. talking about Kiss vinyl for the last year and a half of their life. You know, yeah. that they're just buying records because they think it's cool, and when they see something pop up that they've never seen before, and on an eBay auction that says super rare blue vinyl copy of Love Gun from yeah. the UK, and they pay $75 for it, or even $50 for it, or $200 for it, they're getting ripped off because they're not getting what's advertised. Yeah. You know?
You've got that, and the other part of this for me is, and people just, they it just doesn't occur to them, and I kind of get that. But when you support these people, right, the scariest counterfeit Kiss record to me right now and always has been, and it isn't what somebody think I'm going to say either, it's that 7001 Kiss that we found about a year or so ago.
Yep.
Okay? The only reason why anybody, first of all, who counterfeits a $15 record? Because that's what that is, okay? If you go out and you find, I don't care if it's in excellent condition, I may give you $20 for that. Somebody else may pay you a lot more. But if you put that record up, the original 7001 on eBay in excellent condition, if you get more than $20, you're lucky. Who counterfeits that? I'll tell you who counterfeits that. It's a guy that's practicing.
Yep.
It's the guy that has probably slipped something else out there on us that we haven't found.
That's right.
We found this because he had a typo on it.
Yep.
You know, that's why we found it. That and the trail off. And, you know, it's too big. But you don't know what he's done that you may have bought and paid huge money for.
Yep.
That's the problem. You can't have ethics. Man, this is in my line of business, which I'm not going to get into too much, okay? I'm in a highly regulated business that I a whole lot of what I do, and it probably wouldn't shock y'all really if I showed you what I do. I'm in charge of regulations and accreditation in highly complex systems. I keep records, just these insane amount of records, and I got to hit them every time. I've got to get everything just right every time. So big shock there. I'm a black and white guy.
Okay? Yeah.
You can't have ethics that slide based on your circumstance.
Right.
Okay. You're either against counterfeits or you're okay with them. I own some, but I'm not okay with them. You know, I've got them as much for research as anything else. I can tell you you know, and we'll talk about these in a second. Like, I've got all these picture discs uh-huh. that are counterfeits. I didn't buy them. I traded somebody for them, you know. And so I guess I sort of bought them. But, yeah. You know, you can't say it's okay because I want a blue vinyl one and then be mad when you actually save all your money up and you go out and you buy a copy. Now, there is not a known counterfeit of this, okay? I'm just saying, if there was. And you go out and you spend $300 on a copy of the originals too, and you find out 3 years later you got ripped off.
That's right.
And then you're madder than hell.
That is,
you know,
right.
You're not okay with it then. That's why should somebody be okay that's just getting started in this?
That's,
you know,
right.
And if you want to if that's what you want to collect, that's great. But man, don't think that's okay for everybody else.
That's right.
Look, here's an extreme example. I'm assuming we got no kids in here, okay? Just because you like to have feces rubbed on you while you're having sex doesn't make it okay. Okay? Nobody else likes that. Exactly. You have to use extreme examples, Jason. Extreme. But you get it. You get it, right?
Yeah. Well,
just because you're weird doesn't mean it doesn't make it okay. All right? All right. So let's talk about some here. So let's do a quiz. Let's do a quiz. I'm not going to show you the back.
Yeah, don't show the back.
Counterfeit, authorized bootleg. We got a KISS logo up here. You know.
What's the content?
It is a I can't turn it around. Live concert from Rome.
It is
in 1980.
It is a bootleg.
It is a bootleg. Absolutely right. And again, I could see where somebody could maybe say, well, it's got the logo, so
it's a
maybe it's a subset. But I think for our purposes, we can separate counterfeit from bootlegs that way.
Okay.
We'll go here.
I didn't know I was going to be.
Yeah, yeah. I'm keeping tally of these two.
That, that is a bootleg. Right. I own that back here, by the way.
Okay. Do you own, what number you own? I don't know how I got this. I got number 17. I don't even know how I got that. Yeah, and I'm not a bootleg guy, but this is pretty cool, and everybody says it's a great recorder.
23.
Nah, I beat you, man.
You did beat me. No, this is a great piece. You know, it's got the live stuff from Davenport and Wildwood, where they actually recorded live and stuff like that. It's good stuff. Been Cleveland, so.
Okay.
So anyway,
don't jump right to this.
Okay. Gotta think about it.
Yeah, no, you don't have to think about it, but I want you to wait. Okay, so we got a Dress to Kill picture disc.
Okay.
Got Stemmer on it there.
Yep.
That's, you know, so is that, you know, this is part, oh, and it's, look, it's got the code number.
Oh, we can't see.
Where it. Is it? Right there. Code number right there.
But it's the code number, but it's not numbered.
Correct.
Because the picture disc, the Netherlands picture disc, actually has a number on it.
Would it matter if it had a number?
Well, it would make it more convincing.
It would, because this is totally a counterfeit.
Totally counterfeit. Yeah.
This was never authorized. It came out after they did the initial pressings of a bunch of the KISS LPs. You know, they didn't do Dress to Kill, didn't do Alive 2, Double Platinum, didn't do the solos. This looks very much like one of them.
Yep.
But it's a counterfeit.
Yep.
Okay. Doesn't matter that it never was released on a picture disc before. It's still a counterfeit.
That's where the hang-up is. A lot of people always think a counterfeit had to have been released, you know, that way previously, and that's not the case.
No. That's when they want to start breaking it down into pirates and fan-made. Right. Here, you know, this goes back to elementary school. Here is the world of counterfeits. Mm-hmm. Within that is the subset of pirates. Every pirate is a counterfeit.
That's right.
Every fan made, unless it's a bootleg, is a counterfeit. Okay. Right. They are part of the bigger counterfeit picture.
Right.
Okay. We got the Alive single disc from Mexico.
Yeah. Counterfeit.
Counterfeit. Was not made in Mexico. Was made in Europe. It's got KISS logos. It's got manufactured by KISS Army Mexico, you know, so yeah. All right. It's sister.
Counterfeit.
Counterfeit. Oh, how can that be? It says KISS Online.
Oh.
www.kissonline. How can that be counterfeit, Jason? I bet there's even some registration and trademarks on there.
You sure do have a lot of damn counterfeits, Tom.
I have three. I'm not against them, man. I'm not, you know what I'm saying? It's just identify what they are. Don't act like it's a great, like this is a piece of shit right here. Yeah. Okay? It is. I love the music. I love the guys on it. And this one, I believe, this one might even be, no, it doesn't say it's a promo on here. Now, see what I don't have in this pile? I don't have a Psycho Circus. You know, the one people were paying $300 for the promo copy of it that you can get for $30 now because they keep making them.
Yep.
You know, and it's counterfeit. You wanted the best, you got the best. That's counterfeit. All right, here comes an interesting one. What's this?
That is a counterfeit.
Yes, this is a counterfeit. Man. This is... That's what people wanted to call them, fan-made. I'm sorry if by fan-made you mean the fan's a counterfeiter. Yes. And you even got the labels with it. Okay, so sticker labels that you put on your genuine record, this package, I don't give a damn if the record is original. This is now a counterfeit.
That's right.
Okay?
Cut and dry. Black and white.
Nobody's ripping Gene off with this because somebody bought the Lick It Up. It's still a counterfeit. And, you know, I'm sorry, man. I don't even like these things. These guys act like these are so much better looking, but you know what? That's an opinion, and I'm okay with that. If you want to come on the page and go, Tom, I think that Lick It Up is the best looking thing ever. And I would tell them that, you know what? There's a good chance what's attractive to me and what's attractive to you is two different things. And that's okay. That's okay.
You don't have the record in there?
No, I don't have a record in there. Why the hell would I counterfeit it, Jason? Damn.
I thought you might have acquired it with the record.
No. That's the way they were selling those. I was given that, actually.
Gotcha.
And the guy's cool. He gave it to me. I think he was trying to get me, you know, to look at it like, oh, these are really nice, but, you know, I'm kind of militant that way. Okay, so now we got one with a KISS logo and an OB, and it's colored vinyl. What do we got there, Jason?
That is a bootleg.
That is a bootleg, and it's a damn nice done set.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's the thing of it. To me, I get it that bootlegs have some intrinsic value to them that people seek out, you know. Now, I will have to say, I'm not a big fan of all these fancy covers with shitty sounding music on it. Okay. I'm just not. That's why I bought the live outtakes. Which, by the way, I gotta get my turntable fixed. I haven't even been able to play it. Got a short in it. But everything I've heard is that is good quality music on there. You know, it's a good source. Yeah. And you know, these things have all been redone and all that. And, you know, it's got some good stuff now, but like, you know, I want to make sure I use the correct example, because I know there are some really cool packages like that one you showed the Japanese. That's pretty cool and everything. But like when people take a known bootleg that sounds like shit and put it in a fancy new package with posters and stickers and all, and people won't pay it, man, that's fine. If you want to do it, that's fine. I'm not doing that. I don't get that thought process.
I do fall victim to some of that, but as an avid bootleg collector outside of packaging, you know, what you don't see here is about 40, tubs or not tubs, but, these kinds of things, you know, full of CDs and DVDs and terabytes full of hard drives and stuff. I'm an avid bootleg collector. You know, I have thousands of KISS shows, and I enjoy some audience recordings that are done well.
I can imagine.
Yeah, and especially if it's rare shows or something like that. And when those get put on nice fancy packages, I'm kind of a sucker for that. Yeah. You know, I love bootlegs.
If it's good, I get it. And again, it's whatever you like. If somebody likes these counterfeits, fine, go get them. Just don't sit there and go, why does everybody hate on these? You know, and everybody should want them.
And the other thing is, don't try to defend them to the point to where you are saying it does not have a negative impact.
Yeah, because they do.
That really gets me upset, because these things, look, I own 3 counterfeits. I will probably buy more at some point in time. 2 of the counterfeits I bought knowingly. This counterfeit I was fooled on.
Yeah.
And I paid whatever it was, 30 or 40 bucks for this, which is not expensive. But I thought I was paying 30 or 40 bucks for an original Red Pie Love Gun before I knew a ton about them. Yeah. And I was pissed off when I figured, and I think I figured it out on this show. Hey, this is a damn counterfeit, you know?
Yeah.
So that happens over and over and over and over to people who have no clue.
It does.
And that's not fair.
And here's another example, because we were talking about this earlier. You have some of each, or have had some of each. Okay. The Japanese solo picture disc.
Yep.
Okay. Now again, people can sit there and you can say, oh, you don't know or whatever. I got a degree in finance. Okay. I watch collectibles in addition, have for decades. If you step back to 1990, if you wanted one of the solo Japanese picture discs, you ain't getting it for under 500 bucks.
Right.
Okay. 1990. All right. What'd you just pay for one? legit, and it's legit. Go ahead, and you can say it. You don't say, I have to say who or which one. It doesn't matter.
I paid $300 for Gene, and I paid a hair over $200 for a complete Paul, $225 or something like that.
Let me ask you something. Let me ask something, and everybody in this audience, ask yourself if you know about these records. Mm-hmm. Is there a lesser demand for those records today than there was in 1990?
Nope.
I would say that there is a far greater demand for them. So they pressed X number of those discs in 1978. I don't know when the counterfeits came. I think it was after 90. But anyway, whatever that number was that they produced, it has not gotten bigger.
Right.
Okay? It has not. The demand for it has gone up because there's more people involved in collecting them. Plus, you even know about them. I didn't even find out about them till about 1990. Didn't even know they existed.
Right.
Okay? And couldn't afford it. So if the supply stays the same and the demand goes up, and even if inflation hadn't gone up, the price went up. But inflation has gone up. That should easily be an $800 record today.
That's correct.
But it was $250. Gosh, Jason, why would that be?
Because there is a flood of counterfeits in the market. Not just one pressing of them where they, you know, pretty much replicated it and just had red letters on the back of the jacket. Mm-hmm. But then they subsequently just made counterfeits of the counterfeits over and over and over and over and over again. And you can get those things all day long.
That is a true damage of a counterfeit.
Yeah.
And that's the part people don't pay attention to. Yep. Okay. As long as supply and demand stay the same, prices stay level. Look, this is just basic economics 101. If the supply falls, let's just say that every copy of that record is held in a warehouse and half of them get destroyed in a fire. If you still got the same demand and less supply, the price goes up. But when you got the demand sailing up in a time frame of 30 years for inflation, and that record sells for less today, half today of what it sold for then, that's the damage from counterfeits.
That's right.
And people can sit there. I'll be glad to debate them on it if they want. I'll be glad to talk about it if they want. I'll be glad for somebody to explain to me exactly why it isn't the case. Just be sure to give some kind of an idea of what your background is so that it makes sense.
Right.
I'm not saying I know it all. I'm just telling you basic economics.
Right.
There's no way that thing has gone down in value.
Right. I honestly haven't seen a legitimate Japanese solo picture disc in the last 3 or 4 years sell for more than $400.
Yeah. Yeah. The bottom's falling
out.
Not
a single one.
Yeah. Bottom's falling out.
I paid $400 for my.
And here's another good way to get on the bad side of this page. Tell us that's a good thing. Tell us that's a good thing, because that is not a good thing. Everybody doesn't have, everybody's not entitled to buy everything.
I'll
tell you right now that I paid a lot of money for that Burns Media LP. And had I not sold a record to a member on the page to fund most of it, I wouldn't have been buying it. You know, I'm not entitled to that record. You know, if you're going by that thought process, see, this is that you have to keep your ethics standard. If that was the case, I'd just go steal it. Then I get it for free. You know, I mean, you either got ethics or you don't.
That's
no,
right.
Sir.
I agree totally. I am on board.
All right. Well, we don't want to lose the audience here. So, you know, again, we don't censor. You're allowed to have any opinion you want on there. You might want to read the editorial position of the page. And, you know, if you've got a lot of problems with that, you're probably just not going to be happy there.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Well, let's talk about oddities.
Oddities.
Junk that, you know, you can't get everywhere.
Did you call it junk?
Yeah, man, junk. Sure, man. Stuff, junk, whatever. Let me give a couple of examples here real quick of what I don't think we're going to cover here. Okay, you tell me if we're wrong. But, okay, so we're going to cover, like, if the rest of the world has a certain cover on the record and a country has something markedly different, we're going to talk about that, right? With the exception of We're not going to talk about Japanese just because they have an elder or an obi on it, because they all have obis, right?
Right.
And like, we're not going to talk about German pressings from 80 to whenever it was that had the censored logo, because they all did.
Right.
Okay. And consequently, the 2014s of the Germans all have that, even though they don't have to. So we're not going to talk about that. A couple other things that we won't talk about. I'm going to show two really unique Australian records. I like them a lot, but they don't really fall under this. So here we got the Casablanca file, okay? And the reason why we're not going to talk about that is because it's got all these artists on it.
Right.
So that would also cover, like, Return to Casablanca in the U.S., you know. All right, and then here's another one. So Kiss the Singles, okay? Because hell, maybe we could have talked about it.
I was like,
slide that back down there. Yeah, let's slide that back down there. So we're not going to talk about compilation stuff that's got other stuff. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Y'all didn't see that one. Okay, all right, man. All right, so where you want to start? I've got mine starting with the first record.
I don't have any kind of major order here. But
And we're also not talking about counterfeited crap with fake logos and stuff like that.
Okay. I mean, if you got something from the first label,
I do. And I just say we're not going to do Japanese with with the obis. But if you look over my shoulder, one way or the other, where is
other
it?
Side.
Yeah, other side. I've got my Japanese black box, and it came with colored vinyl. Nice. So that's first LP with blue vinyl, a real blue vinyl, not a counterfeit. Man, I'm going to watch this. I got tons of records here. I'm going to end up hurting myself for my records.
Well, make sure you hurt yourself first.
Yeah, ain't that the truth? I don't know how I'm going to do this. Let's see. Okay. Here's that. All right, so I guess
somebody vacuuming at your house?
No.
Okay.
I think I hear that too. It's not here. Hell, ain't nobody vacuuming in this joint.
Maybe somebody's outside with a leaf blower or something. I don't know.
All right, so let's move on to Hotter Than Heck. What have you got for that?
Hotter Than Heck. I'm going to beat you. I have this.
Okay. I'll let you beat me. I have it right here in my hand, but I didn't want to pull it up. All right.
We want to talk about where they're from and everything?
Do it. You pulled it up.
Argentina.
Okay. What's the deal on it? What are they doing with an original pressing like that? It wasn't an original pressing, Jason. Come on.
What do you mean? Yeah.
That's not the first release of that.
Oh, no. Yeah. It wasn't. You're right. This was released in early 80s, right?
80, yeah. Oh, well, let me check. I happen to have stickers on mine, unlike some people. And I can read mine, unlike a bunch of these, I see. 1981.
Maybe Andrew will help me that when it comes up or something.
Well, is he going to give you his eyeballs or do the stickers?
He's going to do the stickers.
Okay. All right. So then we got the yellow vinyl from the Japanese box.
Yeah.
And then what else have you got?
Do I have any other Hunter than Hell? I don't think I do, Tom. What else you got?
All right.
Oh, no, I do. I have one.
We got the genuine Red Pie vinyl, you know, as opposed to the fake Love Gun. They haven't faked the Hotter Than Hell, which... you know, this one's got the Love Gun label on it.
That looked
so
well
obviously
played.
Not, huh?
That one looked well played. Did it have the?
Well, that's probably why I put it back in there. I believe the back is a complete piece of crap.
I think the around the label or something is worn off.
Well, dude, it could be. Why don't you just call out the bad quality of my place in there? You know. Let me see here. Yeah, it was actually. Yeah. Luckily, the A side is what's going in.
Well, look, so. You can call out this one because it's Scotch tape together.
And what is it?
This is Mexico.
Oh, yeah. That's actually in great shape for a Mexican. Yeah.
The Blue Gamma label.
Yeah. That's all right. Nice. All right.
That's all I got.
And why did you show it? Just in case anybody didn't pay attention, it's got the...
Oh, yeah. I showed
doesn't
it
say Hotter Than Hell. What's that say? Yeah.
Hotter Than Hell. I haven't read it.
No. I can't speak Spanish, so there you go. All right. Now we're not going to talk about the censored logo that most people think about for Germany, but we are going to talk about the EMI censored logo for Germany, right. This rounded thing. There's not, I'll show you all these, but there's only four records that have this. Kiss, Alive, Dressed to Kill, Kiss, not Kiss. Hotter Than Hell, Dressed to Kill, Alive, and Destroyer.
Right.
There is one with for Kiss, but it's a counterfeit.
Oh, Lord.
It's a sticky labels. Anyway. All right. So what you got for Dressed to Kill?
I don't know. I didn't pull out my pie stuff because I didn't know we would do those. So
being a Warrant fan, I thought every pie would be pulled out.
You're funny. Now, you do Dressed to Kill. I don't have any.
All right. Rounded EMI German logo. I used to hate that. And then I got to the point I thought that's actually kind of cool. And there's not that many. So
yeah,
they're not that hard to find, but they're a little bit of a trick to find.
Yeah. I'd love to get them.
Yeah. You're not going to just whip it out. Okay. Which, by the way, I don't usually go begging on this show. I don't remember if I said this on the air or not. I know I told you. So we're moving on to Live. And the oddest U.S. release is a non-gatefold, okay? So it's a record club, and it does not open as a gatefold. And I, like an idiot, when I was taking my photos for the book, laid this down across the adhesive on the sticker so you can see it's still there. I just need to fill it. So if anybody's got a copy to sell or trade, let me know.
Turn the bag around, and that way
it puts it down. Yeah, that's what I need to do. Yeah, but it's upside down. Yeah, I'd have to turn the bag inside out, I think, really. What else you got for Alive?
I got three some over. Of these later releases. I guess I'll go ahead.
Let's all right. So here's the Germany EMI rounded logo. Again, kind of cool. An odd thing about this, some of these came with blue labels, some with camel labels, and some with one of each. A bunch of them with one of each. All right, hang on till you get to that. And I mean, I've got some actual
lives
here.
Yeah, that's fine. That's cool.
Okay. Japanese purple vinyl. It's an out of the box set. All right, here is one. This is Columbia. Okay. Kind of faded out or whatever, but.
Oh, yeah. It's
black and white. So that's one of these deals where, you know what, that's really crappy, but it's unique.
You know what? I didn't pull out it. You know, Tom, I'll have to tell you, man.
You didn't prep, man.
No. When you mentioned doing this,
yeah.
I wasn't thinking about any of the regular album cover releases at all. Not, you know, I was, even the, in, you know, the insides being different. I was thinking
completely different.
Well,
these are.
I know, right.
All right, so like while you're digging through yours, so here's a UK version of Alive. It's a Pride 3 label, Filmworks label, and yeah. It's got Destroyer and Dynasty in there. I think that's pretty cool.
That's what I was about to grab. So
yeah. So these, you know, there's a bunch of different ones with. And I don't think I grabbed them all, but a bunch of different Alives that have got different LPs in there and missing LPs. And, you know, actually, now I'm thinking about it, I was thinking a German might not have had everything in there. But anyway, all right. And so now we've got, here's an original pressing for Alive from Britain, as opposed to the UK, actually in Britain. And so it's missing Hotter Than Hell.
Right.
Now, I don't think there's any censoring going on there. It just hadn't been released.
That's correct.
So we got that. All right. What are the live stuff have you got? I don't want to steal your glory because I know you got a couple there.
Well, yeah, just this Hotter Than Metal from Holland, which has the side A and B of Alive on it. And then the Superstar from Italy that is the same thing, side A and B.
And actually is the exact same disc in both of them.
Right.
Made in the same country. I had somebody go off on me one time before I realized that there even was a difference on that. You got something from Pablo? Or have they not come?
No, I don't think so. No.
Okay, well, I'll show mine then, because I got these from Pablo. Disc one and two of Alive. All right. You need to get him to get these for you, man. They're tough. And like I say, he did me a hell of a favor. My two copies were just horrid, and I'd had them for, you know, for decades.
He's gotten me a few things, and I'm supposed to be sending a package, I think, soon or something.
Yeah.
I need to get with him on.
Yeah, I think I got a dynasty coming from him. Okay, so that's all I got for Alive. What you got for Destroyer?
I don't know if I have anything, Tom.
Okay. Well, back to the Germans again with rounded logos. This is the last of the EMI.
Yeah, that's cool.
Blue label ones with the rounded logo. So that's out of those four, Hotter Than Hell is the hardest one to find. Well, that's in my pile too. We'll get there.
Okay.
Yes, that's a unique record, man. All right, so we got the Japanese box set, the aqua colored vinyl, which is this? I can't remember. Is that gatefold? I'm gonna have to open it. I can't remember. I think it's gatefold.
I haven't opened it in forever.
No, it's not gatefold. Never mind. All right, so got that. Here's a cool. Got Canada.
Nice.
So gatefold. You got your gatefold, Jason?
Yes.
I thought about your homemade gatefold.
Oh yeah.
I'm going to pull that out.
This is the rarest kiss record of all, Kyle.
Let's see. All right, so we got that.
That would be a good Japanese one to show, too, because it has the gatefold.
So. I don't have it. I do, too. Because it's got the OB. Yeah, you're right. You're right. I should have pulled that out.
Yeah.
There's a France one like that as well.
We need to. Oh, how about that? Made me think of other stuff. Keep going.
Okay. Here's another Canadian Priceless Collection. And the only difference on that's that Priceless Collection across the top.
Yeah, I need to.
They made
that.
In Canada. They made that and Dynasty. Don't know why nothing else. All right. I'm show you Summer Tour one or something else.
No, there. You show yours. I'm looking.
All right. So then there's the Summer Tour Sampler, which of course is just a USA only. All right. What else you got? Because I'm ready to go Rock and Roll Over.
Where go to Rock and Roll Over? I'm actually looking for something to Rock and Roll Over.
All right. So Rock and Roll Over. We're going to start with another cool Argentina copy from 80. You know, kind of the one to go with Hotter Than Hell. This is actually one of my favorite Kiss LP covers. I like all that blood.
Totally.
Stuff.
Yeah, I had that.
Now,
here, so.
now, something I did, Jason. So my little personal bootleg thing. I had a guy gave me a recording of the very first Kiss concert I ever went to. It was a Rock and Roll Over show in 76 here in Rupp Arena. And so I took this and photoshopped it down to fit into my CD case, and I put pictures from the show in there.
Cool.
So I'm a counterfeit.
I just want to show that I have that as well. I'm very proud of that. So.
All right. Let's see. We got Rock and Roll Over from England Pie without Love Gun on the label. And this actually, even if it didn't have the red vinyl, I'd have pulled it out because it's, I'm sure you can't see it there.
Yeah.
That's more pink than it is red on that saw blade. So that's unique.
So
all right.
Since we kind of forgot about Japanese because we were leaving out, you know, here's the Japanese. Did you have that to show?
Actually, I don't know why, but the gatefold is there on the Rock and Roll Over in the box set as well.
That's weird. Yeah.
It is weird, and I never paid attention to that. I think Love Gun is, too. We'll see here in a minute.
All right.
Okay, so here we got 30 Anos de Musica Rock, which is Rock and Roll Over that was released with the Elder photo on it there. It's also got a Dynasty one. What was the date on that? 1984. No, is that? Oh, wow, I got the wrong date on the front of this. 1984. There is also, and I forget the name of it, El Toda or something. Same record. The most ass ugly record cover I've ever seen from Mexico. But anyway, I shouldn't say it. Some kid probably won a contest for that painting. But it's ugly. U-G-L-Y. You ain't got no alibi, you ugly. All right. Then we got the Rock and Roll Over Special Edition.
Yep.
From the U.S. only. If you got that in color, you paid a shitload for it and you bought a counterfeit.
That's right.
All right. So, and yes, it is supposed to have the inner sleeve and the sticker.
Correct.
Okay. Love Gun. What you got?
Love Gun. Well, I've got this. Now you go ahead and pull it. You can show one.
All right, so I'll start with from Argentina in 1980, Revolver de Amor, I guess.
That's the one I was grabbing.
Yeah, and I pulled out, I mean, it does have the Spanish titles and stuff right on the front and the back, but mainly because this sticker is apparently on every damn copy.
Yep.
Seems to be.
Seems to be.
Yep. All right, here we go. For whatever reason, this seems to be little known. Australia, just a normal pressing of it, and then at the bottom it's got these LPs.
I would love to get a copy of that.
Well, you should get one of those, because I don't understand why they aren't more sought out and more valuable than what they are right now.
Tom will show this in the box set, or maybe not, but here's the Love Gun gatefold from Japan.
Yeah, no. Well, I'll show the disc. Show for it. Disc. Yes, it is actually a gatefold from the box set also. So there's cool. I'll let you show the next one, the Japanese one.
That's what I just did.
Oh, the next
one. Oh, no.
The next one.
What?
The next one in line. That's the next record. Chronological.
Calm your deals. I don't even have it out.
Oh, come on, man.
Yeah. Go ahead and show it.
You gonna make me dig all that out?
No. I don't know what the heck I did with it.
All right, I'll dig it out.
I'm trying.
I thought for sure you'd want to show that one.
I did.
Okay. The Originals 2, Japan only, has The Story of Rock and Roll Over and Love Gun on it. And what you're seeing in mine, there's not actually two Obies on this. One is a real Obie that's cut off. The other is a fake, a counterfeit that fits on it like it's supposed to. Very scary, because I really couldn't tell you the difference on these if it wasn't for the fact that one of them, that the original one right here, doesn't have the tabs on it. But anyway, there's that. And of course, I think a lot of people have realized this now. These drawings on the front are from the Marvel Kiss comic in the center, where they're drawing the blood from them. And this comes with the three LPs. They've got, you know, the reproductions of the jackets as the inner sleeves, and there are my masks are reproductions. There's these four big ugly masks in there, which apparently nobody ever wore, because most copies do have them. There is a lyric book, and there's also a photo book. It's pretty nice. So it's a real nice package, holds together better than the U.S. originals did. And of course, there's a Japanese original. Actually, all the originals hold up better than the U.S. copies did. All right, so that's the original.
We didn't want to show picture discs, or did we?
Yeah, you can show picture discs. I mean, yeah, I actually pulled a couple of mine out. What are they? You're not at Solos yet, right?
No, I was talking about the Netherlands picture discs.
Oh, pull them all out. The I don't have them, so I can't show them.
I am not prepared.
I had about six of them at one time, and sold them over the years, and just haven't bought them back.
All right, well, let's get caught up.
Because they're awful expensive now. Gosh, wish somebody would make them in counterfeit so I could get them.
Oh, Jesus.
The hell with you guys that paid money for them.
Let's get caught up. So there's the first album.
All right. With that ugly line on it.
Yeah, and I never understood that. And then Dress to Kill is Counterfeit. We showed that earlier.
Yep.
Where is Hotter Than Hell? Probably in the rack here. Here's Hotter Than Hell. Cool piece. All right. Alive is Counterfeit. Destroyer is in here. Why didn't I have all this out? Destroyer is lost. I can't find it. Rock and Roll Over.
The best one.
The best
one. As far as to be on a turntable.
Yeah, I agree.
And don't think for a second that isn't why that one brings so much more than the rest of them. Yeah.
Love Gun.
Yep.
All right. What are we up to? Live 2 is Counterfeit. There's no double platinum. Oh, no, I lied. Destroyer is right here.
All right.
Destroyer was in my lap.
All right. So now we're you're chronologically caught up then.
I'm chronologically caught up. Good deal.
All right. Okay. So now this next one is an interesting one because it is unique to this country. And also, what is that, Jason?
That is
the alive. Best. The Best of Kiss from South Korea.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a counterfeit, but that's the only way that you could get it. All these Korean records like this are all counterfeits. You know, again, they're horrible quality, just horrible. I mean, they pressed them. They pressed them with wore out U.S. stampers.
Right.
I mean, you can now this one I don't know about, but you can pull up a Dynasty and compare it to a U.S. Dynasty, and it's got the same marks in it. You know, they've got horrible jackets to them. I actually like to buy these now when I can get them. The problem with them is the shipping is always so much more. Right. You know, people don't want to pay a lot for these. I mean, it's like a $25 record with $35 worth of shipping included on it, you know? Yeah. So that makes it tough, but you know, they're not good quality to me. They're just an oddity, but they are a perfect example of a counterfeit because they were never authorized to press those. They never paid Kiss or Casablanca any royalties, but that's the way they came. You know, that's right. It. If you're going to buy a record from Russia, from South Korea, for the most part, there may be some of those that aren't. And I'm still not convinced of that even. But that's the only option you got. Okay. So 1978 from Argentina, La Mejor de Kiss.
Ah.
And that says, what's that say? Super, super rare. That's so somebody's family doesn't sell that for $15 or $5 or go, wow, that's a piece of crap and throw it in the garbage when something happens to Tom. But anyway, only place you can get that is Argentina. Highly collectible and it's actually a cool looking release.
Do you have a file somewhere that has all of your text for your labels on it?
No.
Okay.
No.
So you just bring it up by and
yeah. All I do now, I have a sheet, a page on my desktop on a computer that says active labels. And because what I do, you know, like if I get, I mean, I print off like 30 at a time.
Right.
And so it may be 2 months before I do them. So I'll just keep them going, and then once the sheet's filled up, I get rid of them. You know,
got it.
It's, so no, I'm not doing that for anybody.
No. I was thinking that if it was there, it'd be great. Just email me that file, and I'll just print all the things off.
yeah, it would be. It would be. But you know, I realized I wasn't going to be able to keep up with it, and wasn't going to be able to keep it organized. And when am I going to need to print them off again? You know, it's all about me. So.
Well, I understand that. I mean, you never know. Maybe you know, your bag rips or something like that.
Yeah. And it does happen. And you know, that's painful, but still.
Yeah.
but I just put them on the new. So, you know. Okay. All right. So up to Alive 2. All right.
Yeah,
so,
I forgot all about that record.
So we'll start with Alive 2 Part 1 from Argentina.
That's good stuff
there. Tough one to get. I've had this one for 20, 25 years. And, man, I was in shock when I got these because the guy was telling me they were excellent and they're dog shit. But that's about as good as you can do. In fact, Pablo looked at these and said, "Tom, I don't think you're going to get any better." So here's Alive 2 Part 2. So, you know, I mean, you can see the difference in them. And you know, I would never put these on the turntable. They're so bad, but they're cool. They're cool. I like
them. They're
great.
I'd love to have them.
I used to have them up on the wall. All right. What you got?
I don't have hardly anything for a lot.
Okay. Well,
that's
I guess
because Marco has 160 copies of
it. I know. I told somebody today, you're putting off bringing him on because that's probably going to be the end show right there. Right. You know, I mean, it's going to be so much. I did not grab my misprint. I don't know if you want to grab that or not. Shoot. I mean, that is unique. So while you're gone, I'll show this one. Here's another one that should be more sought out than it is, and I think it will be at some point. Non-gatefold from Canada. And this, unlike the one that was on the page a month or so ago, is legit. It's not not homemade. Not homemade.
All right. Since you were talking about it, I have two copies of the Alive 2 misprint here. And I have two copies because one is a cut corner and one is not.
And so let me ask you this. Why are you keeping two just because one's cut corner? Are you trying to get all the versions? Because you got a long way to go, dude. You need three more. I have seen every corner cut.
That's right.
So there's five if you're going to do that.
All right, I'm going to do that. No, I'm not.
Oh, my God, man.
I'm not going to do that. Well, anyway, so let's just show that, you know, we got Take Me There and Hooligan there and what was the other damn song?
Do You Love
Me. Yeah, Do You Love Me. That was the other song. So.
And they sound great, don't they?
Yeah, they're the best sounding recordings I ever did.
Yeah. All right. So now here's Chili, Alive 3.
Nice.
Alive 3. And my buddy Gus, I got this from Gus and Chili. We swapped records on the Kiss cruise, and so he swears he's looking out for me for the part 4. Yeah, because there is one. And, I didn't grab the other one. Okay. Because actually, I've got Alive 2 from Chile, and it's got the discs for Alive 3 and Alive 4.
I remember you saying that.
Yeah. All right. And then we've got the green vinyl from the Japanese box set.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's all. Oh, I think I'd already showed this under Love Gun, right?
You did.
The Russian. Okay, now we're up to double platinum.
I only got a couple of things.
I got a couple of things. You show your couple of things.
Yeah, this. Why do I need to show my couple things first? So, from this was like a budget piece from the early 80s, right, in the UK?
Yep.
I think it's actually called a priceless.
Yep.
You know, but not the same as Canadian. But
correct. Which really confuses me. Hey, while you're showing that though, so that's Pride actually, Pride 8. Okay.
Correct.
So let me and show you labels there.
Oh yeah. So you have the three of the labels. Yeah. So mine are the Filmworks label.
Yeah. So I got the same copy, except for it's got Riva labels. Here in the U.S., John Cooper Mellencamp was on that label. I don't know who all was on it. Somebody said it's Rod Stewart's, which kind of makes sense because it's got this lion wearing a tartan scarf. So that may be. Now, I'll tell you that that inside, there's also an Australian version. It's a little bit darker blue.
Right.
Same thing, though.
Right.
All right. What else you got there?
Tom, I believe that's all I got.
All right. Well, I know you got this. You're just forgetting it. So the U.S., there's 85 pressing that's not a gatefold.
I do have that, yeah.
Right. It's got, I knew you did. It's got text across the back and all that. So there's that. We've got the Taste of Platinum.
Yeah, I was going to
show that. Sampler from Double Platinum in the U.S., only place that was available. That's a tough one. You can be a real Kiss collector and still not have that. So make feel good about that. That is actually a tough one. You're going to have a hard time finding it, and you're going to pay a bunch for it.
Yeah.
Okay. Now I've got my sticker says Brazil, but this is Colombia. All right.
And that's so
it's a little darker, not as shiny, and I'll open this up because this is well worth seeking out to me. This is just cool as hell. It's got elder photos in it.
I would love to have that. Hey, what's the signature up there?
Yeah, I really wish this girl was not in love with Eric Carr, but she was. So, yeah. And I tried to get it off, and it ain't coming off. So there's that. It was still worth getting even with that. And luckily, Tom can Photoshop the hell out of stuff, so the copy in the book looks really nice. All right, and then we've got, I'm going to pull this out too, because I've got this copy from South Korea. Now they got a lot better with their jackets and stuff, and that's what I'm saying. I don't trust any of them, because this is on portrait label, which Kiss has never been on portrait label. That's real label.
I don't think that's the portrait label.
I'm sure it's not. I'm sure it's not. And then some of the worst artwork I've ever seen, again.
Hand-drawn?
Yeah, they're just really crappy.
And that's still a cool piece to have.
Oh, it is. Well, hell yeah. Yeah. But again, it's Korean, so it's not that bad when you see them. Right. Although I may have gotten in a little bit of a bidding battle with somebody on this. Now, there's some of that Korean stuff that's worth money.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, but it's got to be really great condition, and then you're going against some guys with some pretty deep pockets.
Right.
And then...
Shannon.
No, not Tom. all right, and then we've got the Double Platinum, the White Australian.
I quit. And,
for everybody that doesn't know the story on this, you know, the shiny covers all came from the U.S., even the ones from Japan, I'm pretty sure, say, printed in the U.S., although they're much better quality than ours.
Right.
And so... Can't remember if the story goes, they just didn't have them yet over there in Australia, or they ran out. But anyway, somebody decided, well, we're just going to put out these white ones real quick so we can sell these. And Casablanca found out and made them stop it. And so, you know, I guess they pulled them or whatever. They're tough to find. Even if you're in Australia, they're tough to find. And they're pricey as hell now. The last ones now. Somebody will go, well, I know a guy that got one on Craigslist for $30, but if you put that thing up on eBay, you're going to get over $1,000 for it.
Yep.
All right, so now we're up to the solos. What you got?
I don't solos. Have
solos. I know you got something.
Do I?
Huh?
Do I? Oh, other than that, you show
you
it.
Bet. You bound to have. I got a bunch of solo shit here. Okay, so here's the solo sampler from the U.S. If you're going to buy a Kiss radio sampler, you know, this Rock and Roll Over, Taste of Platinum, this is the cheapest one. This is the easiest one to find. That's why it's cheapest. It's so easy to find.
Are we including
because they made so many. So.
Right. Are we including the best of the solos in this group?
Yeah. Yeah, at the end of it, because it's not a solo record, but right behind it. I'm going to show these two picture discs, USA picture discs. There's actually two, and I hear different stuff. I cannot envision that there was a second pressing of these. Some people say there was two pressings. I think they got pressed at the same time.
At different plants?
Yeah, different plants. The prefixes on these things will read NBPIX or NBLPP. And you really don't even need to look at the codes to tell which is which, because pretty much every NBPIX I see is turning yellow.
Right.
On white makeup. Well, can you see the difference on that, Jason?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. It looks like that one came from a smoker's home for about 30 years.
And you know, that's not what it is. I mean, it's just there was something about the process when they made them. I read about it one time. It's not just those records. It's, you know.
Yep. All right. I'll go ahead and show these because I'm sure this is what you were talking about. And I didn't have these pulled out originally either. So I have two. I had three of the four, but right now I have two of the four Japanese picture discs. There's Ace and probably the hardest to find, Peter, both complete.
Yep.
And probably on the next episode, I will show I have a Mint, Paul, or Gene, and Paul coming. Thanks to a good buddy of mine. So I'll finally
Very have cool. that complete. Very cool. All right. What about your best solo? What do you got?
Oh, I've got probably the same shit you have. All right, so Australia.
Okay.
And then you do the next one.
Yeah, you sure it's Australia, not somewhere else?
Not new. What is New Zealand?
Yeah. All right, so do you have the sticker with that?
I do.
People will probably won't see that.
Well, I'll show them that.
All right. There are some counterfeits. There are some counterfeit little stickers running around. I'm pretty sure mine's not. It's got a pencil hole punched through it, but that's all right.
I'm pretty sure mine's not counterfeit, but it's, you know, I think somebody talked about what's on the back of them. This says Fasson or Fasson, F-A-S-S-O-N on the back. What do you think? Real?
I don't know. I'd have to pull my book out. I could tell you if I was looking at my notes for the book.
All right. Go ahead.
Argentina. I like this one a lot. Got a cool, unique picture on the front. Kind of a different looking logo on the back of the school, too. So, anyway, that's a tough one to find in decent shape.
Yeah, right. I got that.
What else you got? Yep.
What else do I have? This is France, I believe, correct?
Yep.
Vogue.
I see Paris. I see France. All right. What else?
All right, who knows? As different as these are, I will say Germany. Yeah, West Germany. So this is common.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a couple different ones for it, although it's not all that unique.
Right. So you can go on.
Okay. And then I've got the same thing.
Right.
Oh, no, it's not.
No!
That's Peru.
It's Peru.
Peru with the German cover. And then South Africa.
That's a good one.
The one from Zimbabwe looks the same. I think they've got a different back on. I'm not 100% sure. And I know the labels are different. But anyway, that's a toughie. That's a toughie right there.
Good one. Good one.
All right. Dynasty.
Dynasty. We didn't show a like a Netherlands version of this one with the regular logo. Do you have that?
I don't have it, no.
Okay, all right.
No. I got pictures of it, but I don't have it.
All right.
Oh, shit. Oh, that's good.
Dynasty. I don't think I have anything very unique.
Okay. Oh, all right, well.
That's a big giant lie.
Yeah, my first one here. Oh, you got it? Okay. All right. Picture disc, yeah.
Picture disc. All right. That's all I have.
All right. First one is Australian, and there's some extra text and stuff on it.
Oh, yeah. That's
cool. You know, talks about the poster and all that good stuff. Then we've got Canada Priceless Collection again.
What all albums did they do in the Priceless Collection in Canada?
That was it. That was it. Destroyer and Dynasty.
And
that was it.
They did solos, didn't they?
Well, they did. They did. And thanks to my buddy Denny, we've got pictures of it.
Mm-hmm.
You ain't never going to find them. because the problem with them is all that denotes it being a priceless collection is a sticker, a hype sticker on the shrink.
Okay.
So if you got one, that's a toughie. I mean, like I would never try to search those out. Right. I'd love to have them. If I came across them, I'd get them. But you know, other than that, okay. Our next one here, I had this and didn't even know that I had this thing. Got to give all credit to our buddy Sebastian Bach for discovering this. This is the Columbia. What do you call it? The Medellin tear of blood or something like that.
Yeah.
He's got a dribble of blood coming down his face, and it's for sure there. And they are not all that way, but it's a printing thing. I can tell by looking at it. It's somebody did it on purpose, you know? So. So he discovered that. So,
you know what we didn't show? Speaking of teardrops.
Oh yeah. You didn't, did you? That's right. You said you were going to show that. Yeah. Go grab that while I'm talking about these.
Go ahead, keep talking.
All right. So now we're going to show, I got a German Bellophone. All right. And, this has got red vinyl, which is pretty cool. It says including 5-color poster, which, you know, I never understand this. This was released in Germany. Why is that printed in English? But bottom line, I don't have that. Now, you'll also see, I don't want to mistake this. I know there are some black vinyl ones that have the bar up here, but they've crudely marked out the thing about the poster. I won't say the black vinyls came like this as well. So anyway, so there's that. And then my last dynasty, no, two more dynasties. We got the white vinyl from the Japanese box set. This one killed me. Brand new, and it might be on the back. It's got ring wear on it, man. Brand new, sealed out of the box. Which, by the way, quit saying that box is sealed if you're selling one. That son of a bitch has never been sealed. It's got a big old sleeve just like this, and ain't never been sealed. So please don't try to sell it sealed. All right, now this is a cool one. I like this one, and I'm surprised that there aren't more people after these, and that they don't bring more money. This Yugoslavian, which has got a totally unique KISS logo on it.
Very cool.
And they're, you know, they're usually in pretty good shape. I think I gave $25 shipped from Europe for this thing.
That's good.
Yeah.
Last of Dynasty?
Yeah, it's Last Dynasty.
All right, so we missed the quote-unquote teardrop rock and roll over RCA Music Club.
Yeah, and I don't care how you say it got there. That's the best thing to call it.
Yep.
I mean, that's what everybody knows what you're talking about.
I just said quote unquote. I wasn't complaining.
I'm not talking about you. Okay. I'm talking generically about people that get all upset about that. That ain't a teardrop. I don't care how it got there. All right. Unmasked. What do you got?
Nothing.
Right. Well, I'll start. We got another Counterfeit South Korean here. You can get these in all different colors, too. Well, not all different colors. I think we've done a pretty good job documenting these in the book as far as the different color variations you can get. Some people want to do that again. That would drive me insane trying to search those down from the U.S. Another Yugoslavian with that same unique logo.
Yep.
Shows up really good on the back. So it's pretty decent. Seemed like there was something real high quality about it. Maybe it was on the Dynasty as far as the inner sleeve. All right, man. What else?
I'm retarded. So look.
I have a counterfeit of that.
Oh, do you?
Yeah. No. Got it from the same source. I got my other counterfeit picture disc from. Well, I got an unnumbered one anyway. I guess I need to check it to see how it's scribed on there.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where I don't care, you know? I mean, whatever.
I had all my unmasked here, so.
Mascardo.
Yeah, good job.
Yeah.
You want to take a stab at this?
No, because I'll just defend somebody.
I wish I could read it. That's cool, man. So cool.
Well, you can read it. It's got English right there by it. If it doesn't pull you one over there, you know.
No, I was just saying, I wish I could read this language, so it didn't sound like a fool.
Yeah, yeah. You wish you could speak the tongue.
Speak the tongue. That's right.
All right.
Super cool. All right, next.
All right. Next is Killers. All right. Maybe I better show. Let me show a regular one first. Otherwise, I'm not sure anybody's going to be able to tell the difference on it. So this is the typical cover for Killers, you know, pretty Kiss Killers, you know, pretty much pink there. And then this from Argentina, and it's just a hell of a lot deeper.
Yeah.
You know, and it's got the text in Spanish on the back, so we got that. And then we've got the Mexicans are actually pretty cool. I didn't pull the one out that's got the typical cover on it. But it's got an elder hand label on it, which is kind of cool. And then this is also Kiss Killers, repackaged from 1985. We got unmasked stuff on there, but you know, clearly that was mass recordings. All right, what else you got?
Got the picture disc here.
Yep. Never did like the back on that. I don't know what it is. Or the front, I guess. I don't know. Just.
You don't like that?
Seems like they got it backwards. Huh. You know? It's not the cover of the record. So.
Right. I gotcha.
Just my opinion.
All right.
What it's worth. All right. What else you got there?
I think that's all I got.
All right. This is a pretty cool record. This is an obtainable record, and it's Old Rock de Kiss.
I've got that.
Yeah, it's from. You forgot that, huh? It's from Brazil. I mean, it's got a ton of songs on it, man, and it's the only place it was released like that. Don't see Mark St. John on the cover too much, but they got some makeup air stuff in there as well.
Yep.
So that's kind of cool. It's a tough one because of the shipping from Brazil.
We talk about some box sets, Tom. Just a couple.
Let's do that. I guess chronologically, actually, I got the wrong one for chronologically, would be the Japanese solo LP box set.
Yeah.
You know, and that, of course, the way that came, according to our friend Alan over in Japan, is when you bought some records, didn't necessarily have to be the Kiss solo records, but that's what most people got, I guess. Then you would get the box as a point of sale material.
Right.
It was a normal retail copy. These are not promo copies of these albums. So they come with the retail Obi. They come with the poster, and everything else that a normal retail copy would have.
Right.
So, it's a tough box. It's fairly valuable when you can get them. I mean, I don't think I've seen one ever sell under $200, and a lot of times they're pretty rough. So,
no, I paid way more than that for mine.
No, I did for one set, and the other set I didn't do too much. But
I would like to get a second one to put my Japanese picture discs in.
Yeah, that's what I think. That's what some other people have done. That's a blasphemy, man, blasphemy. All right. So, the next box set, LP box set that I'm aware of is, the Kiss collection from Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
And, these both look typical, ratty as hell.
Mine's way worse than yours. The bottom.
Yeah. Well, I do not keep the records in them anymore. I've got to find somebody to repair this.
Yeah.
You know, where that's doing that. They're just horrible. Couple of things. And again, I decided to write all over everything, but that's okay. That's at least a problem.
Mine says Roberto Peralta or something like
that. The several interesting things here. Number one, this is the promo release for when Kiss toured Brazil.
Correct.
Right? Not the Vinnie Vincent Creatures LP cover that didn't exist for another 30 or 40 years. The it's interesting. The there's three. Let's see, one, two. Okay, so there's three of these LP covers on the front that have German censored logos.
Uh-huh.
The other three are regular. I'm blown away by the fact they've got Unmasked as the biggest one on here. You thought it would have been Creatures, but that's what it was. It came with is it really a lyric book? I guess it's a lyric book.
Is it a lyric
book? I think maybe it's either a track list or a lyric book. Anyway,
this is just a track list book.
Okay, so yeah. It comes with the track list. Some of them came with a certificate. Maybe all of them did. I don't know.
Yeah.
I have good images of all those for the book. I don't have that.
I bet mine's not original.
Out of the three sets of these that I've compared, mine and Jason's and our friend Marnik, there are some series Azure in there. Yeah. And as far as the pressing series, it's not on all the LPs. Between our three sets, it's on all six LPs, but it's not the same LPs in my set and your set and his set. So it kind of feeds into that thought that they were just getting rid of old stock or whatever. So there is no correct set of discs to be in there. So nobody freak out if they say it. Some people say that did not come in here. The time seems right to me. I don't care. Whatever.
Well, I
have one in mind.
I think this was included in multiple releases.
A bunch. Yes, a bunch.
But anyway, I was just looking at it because it's kind of like a discography.
Yeah,
and I've never really just kind of sit down and looked at it, but I was just looking at it has like three or four featured songs from each album.
Yeah.
So it's just funny what they select, like Rock and Roll Over, See You in Your Dreams, Making Love, Hard Luck Woman, and Baby Driver. Those are the four featured songs.
I like those.
I do too. But you know, it's not Calling Dr. Love and.
Right.
I Want You and that stuff. So music from The Elder is Just a Boy, Odyssey, Dark Light, and Mr. Blackwell.
That's just
interesting to me. So,
anyway. Who knows what the deal was?
Yeah. So.
All right. Next LP box set, we showed the LPs, the right. Japanese, the originals, 1974, 1979. This came out, when did this come out? In 98.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think we've talked about this, and I'm sure a lot of other people have too. You know, when this came out, it was $250 is what I paid for it. I think that may have even included the shipping because it was at a U.S. dealer. And they kept canceling this thing, and then it was coming, then it was canceled, then it was coming, then it was canceled, and then it showed up like 2 days later. And I mean like the project canceled, not just that I wasn't getting it. That was what I was reading. And then, of course, right after this, there's supposed to be, hear different stuff now. I swear the figure I remember is 2,500 copies, and that seems about right. Right after this came out, they did the red box, which is exact same content. The only difference is the color of the box, and $250 is a lot of money. Same price, and I didn't have it. And plus, in my mind, they were going to come out with the purple one and the blue one and the green one. And I said, screw this. And so they just did those. I've heard like 200 copies, 250 copies, something like that. That's probably about right because it sure does bring a premium to this, about three times what this one does.
Yeah.
You know, they're great pressings. The box set is great. You know, I always said they should never try to do another box set after this one, but I mean, they outdid it with Kisteria, obviously. Although I'd prefer to see the color vinyl in the Kisteria.
I agree.
Came with this set of stickers for, you know, they're all a bunch of the picture sleeve stickers. Comes with a set of the Kiss Army cards from the originals, and these are not perforated. They've got the places where you can cut them.
Yeah.
So got that.
You want to demonstrate that for us, Tom?
What, you gonna cut yours? Sure, go ahead. Sure, go ahead. I'm sure everybody will appreciate that. And then this has got a real nice book, and I hate to pull it out because I'm gonna get it all fingerprinted up or whatever, and everybody can read it upside down. Lyrics and photos, and you know, a damn nice book. I mean, that's all you can say. Yeah. So yeah, yeah. So that's it. What other LP bought? Well, you know, we're not gonna pull the Kisteria out because that was such an exclusive, and I wouldn't really count that as a normal release anyway. But were there any other LP boxes?
No, I don't think so. Just Kisteria. That was the only one. I sure ain't gonna hold it down.
I mean, I know that the company that did the light, what was that? That damn abomination that they kept screwing up the deliveries on. Hang on, let me grab it because there is a box. By the way, there's the sealed Obi on this. Mm-hmm. Is not sealed. Never was sealed.
Oh, the company
did this Live 35.
Who concert was, Concert Online.
Yeah, Concert Live.
Concert Live.
They were doing some box a few months ago that was going to include this that they done pissed everybody off about, and I'm sure they were all damaged because they were horrible with their deliveries. And it had a couple of other ones, I think, at the Ritz and something else, and I've never seen one. I don't know if they ever delivered on that one.
I think they did, and I've seen some people post pictures of them, and there was a lot of damage stuff, and it was like this big box, and it had all of this
huge
stuff in it with nothing else in it, you know.
So yeah, stupid, and just a travesty more than anything. I mean, it to me, I that's debatable if that's a legit release or not. I mean, you're never going to see that on a Kiss discography. It's never going to show up. It will be in the book, though. I'm pretty sure that them and Kiss and Universal got something worked out on it because they did let them put it out. But
yep, that's true.
Piece of garbage. Anyway.
Okay.
Yep. All right, on to the next thing.
On to the next thing.
All right.
Next up.
All right, man, next up. And, you know, I don't know if I ever got the year off this thing. Sometimes it's hard to find them on records. But anyway, I know this was in the 80s. This is basically like a K-tail over in Australia of the singles, and it's very flimsy and everything. Got a ton of songs on it. Kiss the singles. You know, it's clearly something that was authorized because it's got the logo on it. I mean, this was a legit company, so, I mean, they would have got their ass sued off otherwise.
Right.
But, you know, it's a tough one, and it's something that's gotten really, really valuable and harder to find here lately. So if you ever do find one, just beg them to take the disc out of the jacket before they ship it, because it'll slice right through it.
Are you going to First Kiss? I think this came out before, and I don't think you had this.
Go ahead.
All right.
Oh, well, I've got it, but I wasn't going
to. Oh, do you? You weren't going to pull it out?
No. Yeah. Go ahead. Do. I'm going to tell you, I don't have that in the book. I'm not putting that in the book.
You're not putting it in the book?
No, man, because the more I looked at it, I mean, talk about it, because, I mean, it's a Kiss record. But it's not a Kiss record.
Yeah, it's the guitar technique of Ace Frehley, and it's just some Japanese guy playing Kiss songs, right?
Yeah.
So,
which is, you know, it's cool. I mean, you know, I spent a lot of time looking for one and getting one.
Yeah.
But yeah, the more I thought about it, I'm like, nah, can't really put that in there, you know.
Okay. All right.
All right.
What's up next?
Okay. Then. The U.S. promo for Hot in the Shade, First Kiss, Last Licks. You know, this was the first real collectible record that came out as I was actively a record collector. I remember seeing this in Goldmine, and it was like $25. And I really busted my butt to try to get one. In fact, I may have said this before, and I apologize if I have, but... I remember calling a guy in Alaska that had an ad up, which, you know, if you're going to run an ad, that's what you're going to get. You're going to get calls. But it was gone by the time I got to him. By the time I was able to grab one within a few months later, it was like $85. And, you know, to be honest with you, I don't think it's gone up a whole lot since then. I mean, it's over $100 record, but, you know, it seems to be easy enough to get. They say there's, what is it, 800 of them?
That's the word.
So. And that's not a small number. You know, I mean, so I think that's part of it. People talk about it maybe being counterfeit, and what you're supposed to look for to show it's not counterfeit is these smudges inside of the thing.
I've never seen one without it.
That's what I was gonna say. As far as I'm aware, nobody has. If you ever did want to look for something else, and actually, even if you're not concerned about it, I mean, this would be the thing that would, to me, would tell you that it's not a counterfeit. I mean, it's very difficult to see it, but up around Gene's head, there's gold glitter, and I can't feel it. I can't feel it, but it's there. It's embossed into it somehow. Maybe embossed isn't the right word, but you know what I really liked about this record, and I made the same comment today about there's an English equivalent to it that's a gatefold. You know, but also was released as a single. But anyway, you know, this was when they first reached back to that makeup background, you know, kind of re-embraced it. And you know, it wasn't too much longer. I mean, they obviously, from stuff you hear now, were talking about a reunion even
Yeah, I
back
mean,
then.
you had that, and then you had the Rise to It video where Paul and Gene put
Yeah.
the makeup on, and you know,
Yeah.
there was talk around that time of doing something with Ace,
Yeah.
and they got on stage with Ace, the Limelight, and played in '89 or something like that, you know, so definitely
Yeah.
rumblings then, so.
Yeah. And you know, of course, you know, Eric Carr died soon after this, but that I tell you, if it would have been possible to get his signature on something, man, this would have been a record I'd have been killing myself to. That's a bad term. I would have been really trying hard to get this thing fully signed, but since he's gone, I just don't even want to try. Now, I heard a tale, and I would say it's real, based on the person that told me. Somebody took this up to give it to Peter Criss to sign at a convention back in the early 90s, and he slung it away and told him, get that bootleg shit out of there. He just, I guess, because he had never seen it. But this was also the first time, and I kind of got it at the time, although I think I did kind of go like, well, what's that about? And this is the first time I remember them having just Gene and Paul on something like that in makeup. And you know, I get it, and then you know, and then I don't. I mean, you know what I'm saying? It was actually a sign of what was coming. And whatever, you know, it's their record, so it's a cool record to have. You know, I think everybody ought to be able to find one if they want to find one. And you know, it's cool record. Cool
Now,
record.
let me ask you something, Tom. Why did we skip Creatures and the Elder?
I don't think there's really anything unusual in there to speak of. I mean,
Well, there's this.
okay, I don't have that, so that would be
No.
one thing. I can't pull it out if I don't have it.
That's true.
Where's that from?
And this is from Argentina, isn't it?
Yes,
Yes.
you're
I'm just
talking
making
to
sure.
everybody.
Hey, man, sometimes I don't remember. Remember, I don't have all this stuff in my head.
I
That's
don't either. I
that
don't
was
either.
that was your excuse.
Yeah,
So,
yeah.
but
And just because you got a podcast don't mean you know it all, Jason.
that's
Remember
right. That's right.
that.
Hold on, because don't go anywhere.
Okay. Don't fall out of the chair and hurt yourself.
No.
You beating yourself?
Well, I was trying to find my damn picture disc. I can't seem to locate it. But are you still with me?
Yeah, I'm here.
All right. I mean, we definitely needed to show the glow in the dark
Oh, that's a
vinyl.
good point. Okay, I'll grab mine if you couldn't find yours.
No. Not put your headphones in, Tom.
All right.
Original yeah. USA picture disc.
Yeah. I have that. I had that picture disc. I was
and actually, to... this is not the original
USA picture disc.
Have you ever seen the original USA picture disc? It was a promo. There was just not many of the things. And no, I got a picture of it. It'll be in the book. I honestly can't even remember where I got the picture. But it was in store promo, essentially for just display, because everything I've ever read or heard about it, it didn't even have Kiss music on it.
Really?
Yeah. But there's also, there is a black and white version out there. Counterfeit. Fake as hell. The guy's been trying to sell it for years on eBay. And I mean, asking like $3,000 and stuff.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Before we quit, because we definitely want to, this was the picture disc I was talking about. I couldn't find Netherlands. So there's that. And then, of course, we have the Elder.
Yep.
Yep. And then we have Lick It Up.
Beautiful.
And we have Animal Eyes. And we have Asylum, but I don't have it.
I always thought it was amazing as those started to get to be worth some money. Because they all had the same number of pressings.
Right.
And the value discrepancies between them, you know?
For sure.
I mean the price that you could get for Rock and Roll Over versus an Animal Eyes was like insane.
Yeah.
And it goes back to demand again. It goes back to supply and demand. If the supply is the same and the demand is higher for something, it's going to bring more money.
That is very true. You know, I guess we should have showed this too. There's the U.S. Crazy Nights picture disc.
Yeah, it looks like the German one pretty much.
Yeah. The what?
The German one.
There's a German picture disc?
Yes. It'll be in the book, man.
Okay, good. Hold on.
Monsters of Rock version, too.
Oh. You know, honestly, I'm unaware of that. Well, there's other stuff here that I know that we're missing. I can't find my Asylum picture disc.
Oh, we'll probably have another show.
Yeah. Well, anyway, there's a couple other things. So, but anyway, that's a large bulk of it right there.
That is, man. That turned into a surprisingly long show considering we didn't know what we were going to talk about.
I know, you know? I know. So one thing I wanted to go back on real quick with the bootlegs and counterfeits and stuff is I think the bootlegging has got so advanced with packaging and the types of pressings that they're doing is I think we're starting to see some merged, you know, boundaries for sure in that where...
Oh, you like mean like the same people doing both? Yes, absolutely.
No. That's not what I mean. I mean where you've got something that you would legitimately call a bootleg normally, but now it's starting to include some real counterfeit stuff in it. So this Elder box that's coming,
you're right.
That Elder box where it has a ton of bootleg stuff in it and demos and live stuff, but it's got a counterfeit picture disc of the San Remo release inside of it. Well, so,
for my opinion, the individual pieces can be different stuff.
Yeah, well, that's what you're looking at then.
Let me ask you this quiz, see if you paid attention when somebody's talked about this.
Mm-mm.
Can you think of an example of something that has changed classifications, legitimately changed classifications? And I wish I'd have thought of this. I didn't. And I'll tell you who did one, because since I tell you, you'll know what I'm talking about.
I don't want to waste any air time here. All right. I'm not sure.
Our buddy Pablo's the one that came up with this, and he's absolutely 100% right. Carnival of Souls. When Carnival of Souls was first released, it was a bootleg.
Yep.
Because it was not intended to be sold commercially. It hadn't been offered. Well, you know, there was no nothing about it was intended to be commercial. And as soon as the CD got out, it turned it into a counterfeit.
That's right. That's a good point.
Yep.
Way to go, Pablo.
He absolutely was right. He absolutely was right. And that's what I say. Stuff makes sense. It doesn't mean that it can't move or whatever. And just like you're saying, this melding now of a package that includes counterfeits and bootlegs, just have to treat them all individually, in my opinion.
That's right.
It would be no different than like that set you showed that came with the counterfeit guitar picks.
Right.
So not even musical media, but they're counterfeit.
That's right.
And so, you're right. There's a melding of it. There's counterfeit posters come out and that stuff.
Now. Oh man. Yeah. It's gotten insane. In the middle of that, I felt like I was going to ask about something else that we didn't show or talk about. Elder. What was it? Can't remember. I'll remember after we stop recording.
Sounds good. There was
another piece. So, but yeah, so that's it. That's all I got.
That's all I got.
Are we done?
We're done.
We don't need to wrap up. Nothing to reiterate.
No? Later.
All right. We're late. All right. We'll see you on the next one.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
Want more wax? Visit us at www.kissmywax.net. Download the show on iTunes or email us at contact@kissmywax.net.
Kiss My Wax fans, get your very own Kiss My Wax slim mat by going to kissmywax.net.
All right.
This goes on my turntable, huh?
Yes, sir.
I love it. Thank you very much.